So thank you for that introduction. I hadn't thought about my dissertation in like 25 years. I want to thank you for inviting me. I want to thank Steve Coxford for endowing this lecture, and thank you all for being here. I'm very delighted to be here. Okay, so my talk is going to focus on the question of what, if anything, is wrong with privatizing education and prisons. To put the question in context, we know that national governments have been increasingly outsourcing some of their responsibilities. So in the United States, over 25% of social welfare service provision has been contracted out to private entities and involves most notably religious groups. So a lot of the social services that are provided by the government are provided by the government contracting with religious agencies. The federal and state inmate population housed in private prisons has increased by 56% between 2000 and 2013, and I'll give you some more statistics a bit later in the talk. Even national security is being subcontracted. So in 2003, countries spent an estimated, this isn't just the United States, this is the Western world, an estimated $25 billion was spent on private military services. So why should we care about this? What difference does it make if governments privatize many of their functions? Is there something special about government provision? And if there is, what is it? That's what I want to explore today. Part of the difficulty in answering these questions is that privatization is a concept with many meanings, and it covers a lot of institutional forms. So for example, privatization has been used to refer to the government selling off assets to private individuals or firms. So you can think about the British government's sale of council housing under Thatcher. The government abandoning or disengaging from producing particular services. This is so-called privatization by attrition. You just let the thing that you own lapse. The deregulation of public monopolies, and the government contracting out its services with private entities, including those of the nonprofit sector. So it's hard to generalize about privatization when it covers so many different institutional forms. So I'm going to narrow my focus, and by privatization, I'm going to mean the transfer of the production of resources and or services from the government to the private for-profit sector, although some of my concerns will hold even when the private entities are nonprofit. So I'm going to be considering cases where the government provides for the financing of the services through contracting out or through vouchers. So in this sense, privatization diminishes the operational but not the fiscal sphere of government. Government still has to raise taxes to provide for the prisons and the schools, but it's the implementation that the government is contracting out. So a few things follow from this definition or this focus. Competition is not a necessary part of privatization because the government could, in principle, contract out to a privately held monopoly. Nevertheless, the cases I'm going to look at all involve competition in some form and to some degree, but it's not necessary. And finally, one other thing I'm going to be concerned about is that the resources and services that I'm going to focus on are ones that governments have a baseline responsibility to provide to people on grounds of justice, and those include a fair distribution of general resources and some specific goods like police protection, defense, criminal justice, education, and health care. Now, I'm not going to argue for that here, and so in our discussion, if you want to, you're Canadians, you probably won't disagree, but if you want to disagree with this, I am prepared to defend it, but I'm just taking that as an assumption. So how should we then assess privatization in the sense that I've defined? Well, usually privatization is assessed instrumentally in terms of its consequences. So we think about what are the consequences of privatizing a good or a service for its, you know, does it make, is it, is there an efficiency gain to do so? And what about accountability? Does privatization diminish accountability? Does it help with accountability? So I'm going to make the case, I think those are two very important parameters for thinking about privatization, but I'm going to try to make the case today for adding a third instrumentalist concern, and that's the erosion of this baseline of responsibility of government provision. So I'm going to try to show you reasons to be concerned that moving a good or service out of the public sector can distort or fragment the requirements to provide that good or service, in part by changing the decision path by which that good or service is produced and distributed. So that's the claim I'm making, and I'll try to support it by looking in detail at two cases. So although my account today is going to be instrumentalist, that is, it's going to be concerned with the consequences of privatization, I want to acknowledge and set aside a class of cases where privatization can be ruled out for other reasons than consequences. That is, it can be ruled out for intrinsic reasons. So these are cases where privatization invariably corrupts the good or service in question. So take the vote. I could contract out, right, to one of you, you know, my vote, and there could even be an efficiency gain. Maybe I don't care about my vote, you really care about having my vote, I delegate you, just go and vote. Vote for me, I don't really want to vote. Even though it's efficient, the reason it's objectionable, or at least one major reason it's objectionable, is that votes are best understood not as the private property of individuals, but they're a mechanism of co-deliberation of the public, right? We want to deliberate together about the public good. If I or other people start moving our votes around, we don't know what we think together. So a system that allowed people to treat votes as private goods would corrupt in some way our understanding of what vote, this understanding of what votes are. And this is an argument for those of you who've read Michael Walzer. Michael Walzer thinks there are many goods of this kind where the meaning of the good, the nature of that good is corrupted when it's, for example, put for sale on a market, or maybe when it's delegated to another authority. Locke had a view like this. He thought various kinds of legal decisions couldn't be delegated to private parties without destroying them. But I think this argument has limited reach. So for example, why should we think that water services delivered to the home through pipes should not be privatized if it's okay to sell water bottles, which we think it is? It's hard to see how the meaning of water or the intrinsic nature of water tells us anything about how water should be distributed. Food is really important, you know, and a really important good, but we distribute food largely through private markets. So it's hard to see why the contracting out of services such as those provided by prisons or schools is different than water. After all, we allow, at least in the United States and actually in Canada as well, parents to send their children to private schools, and even if there are reasons for objecting to such schools, it doesn't seem to rest on the idea that these schools can't deliver an education, right? That the good of education is thereby destroyed. Okay, so are there other intrinsic reasons to object to privatization? Well, I think the strongest non-instrumentalist reasons have been offered recently by two philosophers, Avahai Dorfman and Alon Harel. They argue that only government can deliver certain kinds of goods, namely goods that are what they call inherently public goods. So they argue only the government can run a prison, because only public employees can carry out legitimate punishment. When a prison guard who's privately hired, let's say by a company, walks a prisoner to his cell because this prisoner violated a rule, when it's a private firm hiree, they argue it's private punishment. It looks the same, it's the same movements, right? But now, because the person stands in a different relation to the state, it's no longer public punishment. And I should say the Israeli Supreme Court followed their lead not that long ago. So here's an analogy that might help with understanding their view. So imagine, think about the practice of blood killing, right? So the Capulets and the Montagues. Only a Montague or a Capulet can engage in a blood killing. If one of them came to me and said, you do it for me, you know, I'll pay you, you do it for me, that wouldn't be a blood killing. I'd be, murdering somebody, but my actions, even though they would be the same actions as taken by a member of the family, would have a different meaning. So, because I stand in a different relation. So according to Harel and Avahai Dorfman, only the state, only a guard who stands in the right relation to the government can punish in our name. When it's a private guard, rather than punishing in our name, he punishes in his name, right, or the name of his company. That's their argument. Now in the end, I don't find this intrinsic argument compelling. So why exactly, at least in theory, can't privately hired prison guards perform the same services and actions as public employees? Why does it matter who the hiring agent was, given that the government still oversees the process and takes responsibility? Why can't the government delegate a private guard to act for us, to act in our name? Moreover, some government employees can and do abuse prisoners, and some privately hired guards do not. So isn't that the relevant consideration? So in what follows, I'm going to set aside intrinsic arguments, and I'm going to focus only on instrumentalist arguments. But I have a challenge, to anybody who thinks about instrumentalist arguments faces a challenge, which I think the intrinsic views are trying to capture, which is that our attitudes towards prison privatization seem different than our attitudes towards garbage privatization, which many cities in the United States have privatized garbage collection. So I need to explain why those cases might be especially troubling in ways that garbage collection isn't, but I'm not going to do it resorting to either a Walserian argument about the meaning of goods or a Harel-type argument that you have to be appointed by the state and in order to be an agent of the state. Okay. So to locate my account, I'm going to just begin with the standard instrumentalist take on privatization. And there really are two main parameters that have been discussed in the literature. The first is efficiency, and the second is accountability. So let's start with efficiency. So what's the argument? Well, a classic argument is that private enterprises facing competition and accountable to shareholders have incentives to use resources efficiently by cutting costs. They also have incentives to improve the quality of services to attract customers. because a government manager can't keep any savings from cost cutting and doesn't typically face a competitive economic environment, the incentive to cut costs may be weak, unlike in the case of a private manager. Public managers have some weak incentives to increase quality since they can be replaced, but it might be difficult to replace them. So there's a standard economic argument in favor of privatization, right? Classic economic argument, privatization, you should expect privatization to work better than public provision. And it's a good argument. But critics of privatization can also draw on the insights of economics because they can point to efficiency problems that arise in the presence of natural monopolies like water or electricity, externalities, imperfect information, and other examples of market failure. And in addition, contracting out provision can lead to what are called principal agent problems. And these are, again, familiar in the economic literature. When a principal and an agent are distinct, the principal has trouble controlling the agent. So I'm the government, I contract out with a private provider to provide some service that I want, supposing the service is security. If the private agent is dishonest, right, this can lead to all kinds of problems. So the monitoring costs and the monitoring is bound to be imperfect. Principal agent problems are especially relevant because contracts are not complete, right? No contract is complete. And in the case of prisons or schools, the government simply can't specify all the things that it wants its agent to do, right? There are many things that you want schools to deliver. There are many circumstances. You can't write it all down in a contract in advance. So there's some space for discretion. And in private provision, when you contract out, when there's space for discretion, the space is filled by the norms of the private contracting agent. And the government then has to step in and make sure those norms correspond to the government's. When it's the government, it's easier because it can enforce its norms more directly. So for these two reasons, principal agent issues and incomplete contracts, many theorists, notably Martha Minow, has identified the problems with accountability as the central problems that privatization faces, right? So the central problem is how to figure out how to get accountability in a system that might possibly be efficient, but where there's a worry that the principal can't completely control the agent. So again, I don't dispute the economic analysis. I think the concerns raised by efficiency on both sides of the debate and the concerns about accountability are important. But I want to turn now to my to this different concern, which is that privatization leads, either in direct or indirect ways, to the erosion of what I take to be the baseline purposes of government action. And that's slide 6. Even if a prison or a school system were efficiently run, and even if we were able to exercise accountability over it, we have reasons to be wary of privatization because of because it changes the conditions under which the good is provided. And the rest of my talk is going to sketch this claim with respect to two particular resources or two particular goods, education and prisons. So I'm going to start by talking about education. Actually, it's an old argument that goes back to John Stuart Mill, but it was picked up later, about 100 years later, by Milton Friedman, where Milton Friedman argued that there was a good case for the government financing schooling. And the reason the government had a responsibility to finance schooling is because education has effects, it's not only a private good, but it has third-party effects on other people. So we should finance it, but Milton Friedman argued there's no reason to think that government should have any particular role in providing education. And so Friedman proposed, and this is consistent with my definition of privatization, that every parent be given a voucher from the government, which that parent could take to any school that met certain minimum standards, namely the standards that address the negative externalities from people being uneducated. And so why was this seen as an improvement? Well, vouchers would make greater school choice effectively available to parents, because you could take your voucher to any school. Schools have an incentive to get parents, so they have an incentive to up the level of their services so that people will want to bring their vouchers. And in Friedman's plan, people could take these to any kind of school, whether religious schools, for-profit schools, not-for-profit schools. The idea was to unleash competition and choice in order to drive up school quality. And he argued that this system would not only promote greater diversity in the content of education, but it would allow parents to select schools that match their preferences for their children. So these are the advantages that Milton Friedman argued should lead us to want to privatize education. Now, admittedly, this proposal goes beyond any that have been considered so far in the United States, although some cities have experimented with a Friedman-like plan. The two that come to mind are Milwaukee and Cleveland. But there have been ballot measures to go even further, to allow people to take these, you know, to any kind of institution they want, even regardless of whether the institution has been certified. The new Secretary of Education is a keen advocate of privatization, although we don't know yet in, you know, what form that'll take. But certainly something like Friedman's proposal is likely to be one of the options on the table. So why not? Why isn't this a good idea, right? Diversity, competition, choice, those are really good things, and, you know, general, why not do this? So I'm going to raise three concerns. And again, those concerns are all going to relate back to my view that government has a responsibility to secure an adequate level of provision of certain specific goods, such as education and security. So here's the first concern. The first concern just has to do with the scope of the permissible means that schools are allowed to use to improve school quality or decrease costs. So one important question is whether schools should be allowed to reject or expel hard-to-educate students, and if so, what kind of education these students would have access to. So Friedman makes no provision for this at all in his discussion of this. And that's already a problem with private and charter schools, at least in the United States. Private and charter schools can refuse to educate certain children. Public schools cannot. A more recent proposal than Friedman's by John Chubb and Terry Moe, in their book Politics, Markets, and American Schools, tries to address this limitation of Friedman's view by requiring a fail-safe principle where every child has to be placed somewhere. But a school of last resort might not benefit hard-to-educate children. And the problem here is the more you restrict the ability of the school, right, to push out children, the more some of the advantages of the market system, right, are compromised. Okay, so that's a first concern. That's an internal concern. A lot of it can be met maybe by design, you know, really good institutional design that goes beyond what Friedman or even what Terry Moe has so far offered. But now I want to turn to what I think is a more fundamental concern I have. And that's the concern that diversity in K-12 education has to have limits. So what's a great thing about the market? A great thing about markets is we can differentiate ourselves and segment ourselves, right, in various ways. I can buy the food I like without having to buy the same food as you. I can buy the clothes I want without having to buy the same clothes as you. This is a great thing about a market. We don't need to agree on things. We can distinguish ourselves. But I want to argue that virtue we should be wary of in certain contexts, and education is one of those contexts. And I'm going to point to three limits. So I have three concerns, and this is concern two, and on concern two, I have three limits. So I should go maybe to the next. Let's see, does that help? Okay. So these are, I'm in two, segregation and segmentation. So the first concern I have is that one of the problems about throwing choice open so widely is that it gives parents an enormous amount of ability to shape their children's education. And parents are great. I'm a parent, but I have my son's best interests at heart, but he doesn't always agree with that. And more importantly, parents can choose badly for their children, either because they're dogmatic or short-sighted, they don't have full information. And so we ought to worry about a mechanism that throws so much of the onus on the ability of parents to be good choosers. And in other work I've done, in my book on the limits of markets, I identify a phenomenon I call weak agency. So there are lots of markets or potential markets where the affected parties are not themselves the agents on the market. So children don't make the decisions themselves about where to go to school. Parents make it for them. Prisoners don't get to choose which prison they go to. Somebody makes the decision for them. So you could think of them as weak agents. They bear the costs of decisions that other people make. And we should be worried about markets where there's weak agency. That doesn't mean you can't overcome weak agency. There are a lot of policies that can be designed to make people into, you know, help people make better choices. But when you throw things open, you're giving a lot more power to agents who themselves don't bear all the costs of their decisions. Now, but that you might think we could address the weak agency of parents by regulations. So Friedman, after all, said there's some standards, right, that schools have to meet. So maybe we make the standards, right, decent enough. Like, this, kids have to be numerate and literate. They have to be able to function in modern society in some way. But the state's interests go beyond minimum content standards. At least I'm going to argue this. And they include the makeup of children in a school. So my second concern has to do with the consequences of privatization for further division between groups in society. And that's an empirical claim, so it's an empirical concern. It might turn out to be false, but I think it's something that we should worry about. And the way I would put it is like this: a market-like arrangement for distributing schools might do a very good job matching parental preferences to schools, but a very bad job of matching students with each other. So one question is, again, if you have so much choice plus the ability to exclude, are you going to get more or less segmentation and segregation in society? Again, empirical conjecture that this opens up by giving more room for segmentation and differentiation, opens up more space where you could have division. Now, I know people are going to immediately come back and say, look, the United States already has in its public school system a lot of exclusionary zoning, which leads to a highly differentiated student body. So the question really is, would this be worse? Okay, and third, and this I think gets to one of my core concerns, there are circumstances in which diversity in conditions actually undermines your ability to provide for a good. So my first example of that is from a book published about 20 years ago by John Adams, who wrote a history of car safety. And one of the things, you might not think this is an interesting topic, but it is a really interesting topic. So when seatbelt laws were first enacted, the original laws said only the drivers of the car need to wear seatbelts. Nobody else in the car needs to wear a seatbelt. And you know, when I was growing up, if you sat in the back of the car, you didn't have to wear a seatbelt. That was the kind of norm. And a very funny thing happened, which is the number of deaths went up when this law was put into place. So why would the number of deaths go up? This is a protection. Well, the drivers were now in a different situation than the passengers. The drivers felt safer, so they took more risks. And those risks fell on the passengers in the car. So sometimes, if you want to secure an adequate level of a good, you need to put everybody in the same choice situation. So if you think about the idea that the captain is supposed to be the last to leave the ship, right, to abandon the ship, that's the idea there is the captain should be in the same situation as everybody else. Captain shouldn't be able to get off the boat first. Okay, now it might be objected here that schooling is very different than cars. And in particular, if everybody has a voucher, there's no difference. It's like everybody is a driver, right? So there's no difference between the condition of everybody. But actually, it turns out the structure of these examples is closer than it might seem. So an economist who studies education has done a lot of work on school financing systems. And what she looks at is when schools, which is true in the United States, can raise differential amounts of money per pupil largely through private means. So to give you an example, Woodside, which is a community near where I live, has raised their very small school, and it turns out to be over $250,000 per pupil for their school through private nonprofit connected to the school. And then the Oakland schools have like, you know, $5,000, I think, per pupil, or a little bit higher than that. So what she finds is those funding arrangements aren't stable because people with high funding have no incentive to support the public provision because they're getting so little benefit, and public provision is spread over everyone, whereas private provision just benefits you. So one question would be, would a voucher system where you can take your voucher, use it in private schools, for-profit schools, diminish the idea that education is a public good which needs to be provided for at a very adequate level? So that's the third problem that I see. And then my third and final concern is that privatization can change the structure of governance. Let's see, I guess I stay back here. Okay, so when you privatize things, you give people new, you empower a new group of agents to try and enter the policy space. So in particular, Friedman's proposal would empower lobbyists and powerful actors focused on making education profitable. Now, to be sure, in case I already can anticipate an objection, which is, of course, the current system also, right, empowers various agents, and some of those agents may not be optimal for the kind of education we want. So again, we have a comparative question. And I'll come back to the comparative question in a little while. Okay, so that's education. Now let me talk about prisons. So here's some data on private prisons. So as you can see, the numbers are growing. Private prisons now hold 75% of immigration detainees in the United States. And that's a 2015 figure. So that's 3/4 of all immigrants are detained in private facilities in the United States. Following the 2008 economic downturn, some states, such as Arizona, debated whether they should sell off their entire corrections system to private corporations. This is the privatization of the penal system. This is a New Yorker cartoon, the little prison down the lane. So you can, you know, this is the hope, like you'll privatize and it'll be really nice and they'll have cafe lattes at the prisons. So, and you know, public prisons are not great places, right? Many public prisons in the United States are horrible, terrible places. So if privatization improved those places, then you might think there's an argument in favor of it. So privatization critics of prisons have pointed out that private prisons aren't particularly efficient. That is, they don't tend to reduce costs. They're financed by the government, and they have not turned out to be cheaper than the government. They also have led to decreased prisoner welfare. So the New York Times did an investigative study over the last year and a half. Cost-cutting measures can affect the security of prisoners, the number of escapes, staff and guard conduct, amenities prisoners receive. So there's reason to worry that cost-cutting could influence, and in a negative way, prisoner welfare. There's a famous court case in the United States. I'm mentioning something about law. Medina versus O'Neill, a 1984 case, which illustrates the concerns about the poor quality of personnel in private prisons. This was a guard, so why would there be an incentive to hire untrained guards? Well, they're cheaper to hire. So a guard who was untrained in the use of firearms accidentally shot and killed a prisoner who was trying to escape. So without a doubt, a major concern with private prisons is with their quality. And recent studies have found that private prisons don't do so well on quality, on prisoner welfare, on recidivism. Not long ago, a prisoner starved to death in a private prison. This was written up in the New York Times recently because his medical problems were left untreated. So I'll come back to that. That's very bad. But I want to focus on another dimension of the problem, which has to do with the government's baseline responsibility to provide criminal justice. Delivering these goods through private agencies can undermine this baseline. So first, if you think about the virtues of private prisons, there's a question about efficiency, and as I said, the evidence, somewhat contested, but it's not a knockdown case that private prisons are more efficient than public. Choice and diversity don't seem like an important good in this context. As I said, it's not like prisoners get to choose which prisons they occupy. And lower rates of recidivism, which would be an important thing to consider. We have no good evidence. I should also mention that private prisons, like private schools, can turn down prisoners. So if there are prisoners that they think are particularly difficult, they can refuse to take them. So, all right. So I want to look at this argument about the baseline. And I want to frame it by just asking you, let's forget privatization for a minute. Let's just imagine that instead of police, you know, who are appointed by state governments, we supplied security in different countries totally on the market. So just imagine that, that all security was purchased in a market. So you might imagine that there could be some problems with a system like that. I mean, obviously people would spend very different amounts of security depending on their incomes, but maybe that's not a problem. So people will buy different amounts of security. The problem rather is that security, the companies that supply security will survive only if there's a demand for their services. Right, so one way to ensure demand for your services, if you're a security company, is to try to make people nervous, right? And try to, you know, enhance the, you know, idea that there are threats around. And you might engage in deliberate efforts to increase anxiety. If that's the case, then government's responsibility, you're not getting like an adequate amount of security. You're getting an oversupply of security, which of course is inefficient. So how might the contracting out of the running of prisons to for-profit entities lead to changing the baseline obligations that governments must fulfill? So society, us, we have a strong interest in reducing the amount of crime and reducing the number of people in prisons, right, subject to, you know, appropriate respect for law. But the interests of the private prison industry run in the opposite direction. So I'll give you an example. So one of the largest companies involved in the private prison industry in the United States today, which used to be called Corrections Corporation of America, it's now called CoreCivic. And it regularly engages in lobbying, direct campaign contributions, and so forth that aim at boosting its market share. So here's an example. It was recently unearthed that the private prison industry was secretly involved in drafting Arizona's harsh anti-immigration laws, laws that, by the way, would boost demand for the immigration detention centers. And CoreCivic has recently offered to relieve 48 states in the United States, not Alaska and Hawaii, but everything else. It's offered to buy all their prisons, but only provided the states would agree to keep the prisons 90% full for the next 20 years. In a recent 2014 annual report, CCA, worried that changes to American immigration policy would cut the company's profitability. CoreCivic is now one of the largest employers in the country and is publicly traded on the New York Stock Exchange. Okay, so now why not address these problems through accountability? So it might be thought, look, if the problem is you oversupply or there's, you know, corruption of various kinds, why don't you just increase accountability? The, you know, government doesn't want to just increase the number of prisoners, so we make the private agencies accountable. So you could expand the notion of accountability to cover these cases, but what I worry about is privatization isn't only a means for delivering services, it creates new decision paths and a new set of conditions for the provision of services. And as I said, when you put people in differential condition, what's rational to do is different than when they're all in the same condition, right? That's the seatbelt case. And so the interests that are now empowered might play a large role in shaping public preferences and molding the public in new ways. And as I said, in these changed conditions, what's rational to do, what looks optimal, can be different than when people are put in the same condition. Okay, so let's say that works. Let's hope it works to motivate at least some concern with these two cases. How does this apply differentially to prisons and education and not to garbage collection? Because one insight of the intrinsic view is it seems to capture a discomfort people have. So a lot of people are uncomfortable about the idea of private prisons, even if you said to them, you know, they're efficient and they work just as well. People feel like something like, how can I account for that? So I have four reasons. Maybe I have a slide for this. Let's see. Okay. Why schools and prisons, but not garbage collection? 45 minutes. I'm up. Okay. Well, I'm almost. I'm like 3 minutes from the end. Okay. All right. So segmentation, I've argued, can sometimes undermine provision of a good, and that was the case of schooling, that the kind of level of provision might be undermined by too much differentiation and segmentation. Garbage collection is actually different. I have not only an interest that my garbage is collected, but that my neighbors and the people across the streets and the people across the street, and you know, so there's the segmentation argument at least is somewhat contained in this case, and the risk of individual exit is lower in the garbage case because it's really place bound in a way that potentially schooling is not place bound. There's another reason to be worried about schools and not garbage collection. And this will push back a little bit towards the more Walserian account. So we know that market mechanisms sometimes change social norms. How many people know the Israeli daycare experiment example? No? Okay, good. It's such an overused example, but clearly, it hasn't been used here before. So this is a wonderful example of an instance of norm change through the introduction of a market. So, and it was an experiment done in 6 daycare centers in Israel where parents continually came late to pick up their children, which I was certainly guilty of when my child was in daycare. And so they decided to incentivize parents to come on time by introducing a fine. And just like in the car example, the result of the fine was that parents came later. Because rather than seeing this as something that they should be avoided, they were taking the time. Now they just thought, I'm buying the time from the daycare providers. And interestingly, after 6 months of seeing this not happy result, they lifted the fines. The norms were already in place and didn't go back. Now, if I were an economist arguing against myself here, I would point out, well, of course, make the fines higher, right? You know, if it was $100 a minute, parents wouldn't come late. It was, you know, that it was only $10 a minute. That's true, you can play around with fines, but the fact then is that it costs more to provide the service if you can't rely on the social norms. So there's a question about education, about whether introducing a voucher system and a more market-like provision for education would change the social norms that people think about education, partly as a private good, but partly as a public good. Would this lead them to think more as a private good? That's an empirical question we need more work on. Okay, second, both cases of prisons and schools involve weak agents. Garbage collection doesn't involve weak agents, right? The people who are benefiting are the decision makers. So at least that kind of gap is not opened up. And when people are deciding for themselves, okay, the costs fall on them, right? When I decide for prisoners, the costs fall on the prisoners. So garbage collection is different. Third, there's some goods, so that's second. There are some goods we might think, and I'm not going to argue that here, but there might, and so the equality argument is forthcoming, but not here yet. We might think justice requires these to be provided equally to all. We might think that about education because of its link to equality of opportunity in a way that we don't think garbage collection is linked to equality of opportunity in the same way. I'm not going to argue that here, but if you thought the answer is yes, that might have consequences for allowing more differentiation and segmentation. And fourth, and returning to the problem of incomplete contracts, schools and prisons are places where cost-cutting measures can lead to really, really bad outcomes, right? Garbage collection, not great, but the kinds of harms that could be generated through education and through prisons, you know, including death in the case of prisons, are very severe in a way that garbage collection doesn't raise as severe problems. Moreover, and this now will circle back to incomplete contracts, garbage collection is a pretty routinized activity. So the contract gaps are not that hard to fill. Schooling and prisons are not repeat. You don't have just simple repeat activities. You have a lot of things thrown at you that are one-off cases. And so it's much harder in cases like that to fill in the contracts. All right, so all of this is instrumentalist. All of this could be defeated by evidence or regulations that address the problems. Still, I think the analysis picks out some reasons to be especially concerned about prisons and schools. And I will end on that note since I'm out of time.